Fantastic. Let's bring that on board.
I would love to walk around and hear good doo-wop. Was that ever a thing in New York?
Dave, while I am of certain advanced years compared to a lot of my contemporaries,
I just realized how insulting
I was not around during the doo-wop phase of music.
You were pretty much... You're not that much older than me, really.
No, it's funny because the thing is, I do remember my parents listening to it.
I know, but
that was their Pearl Jam. You know?
Oh, my dad was listening to it because I think for some reason our parents were the same age.
I don't know how that happened, but yeah, it was. They would listen to it. I'd hear it in the car, like the oldies station back when I was a kid played. Like that wasn't like now. You hear Green Day and. STP on the oldies channel.
That's insane to me. No, even in Detroit, it was all Motown or it was, New York, Phil Spector sound from LA, all that shit. Yeah, it's bum boom boom dang dang dang.
Yeah, that was all the oldies channel. Yeah. And it was funny because only old people listened to it. It was the decrepit old fucking channel. But now I'll listen to CBS FM here in New York because they'll play. Older songs from the 90s.
They do the same in Michigan where it's classic golden oldies and it's like, and now we've got another one coming up from R.E.M.
You're like, oh, that's an oldies child. The oldies was
splash, I was taking a bath.
Although if they play the Pearl Jam thing where it's like
they do that.
What's that oldies type song he did?
It was Last Kiss.
Isn't
that it? Last Kiss? When he's just like,
The Lord took her away from me.
She's going to heaven, so I gotta be good.
Yeah, that's like an oldies song that would be played on the oldies channel now because it was done in the 90s.
Yeah.
Okay, cut it off quick or we'll have to pay fucking rights.
Yeah.
Well, they'll cut it off and throw us off of fucking YouTube or something.
That's such a sad song, though. The painful scream that I heard last. Come on, kids. Way, oh, where?
All those oldies 50s songs were all like that.
It's basically about a drunk kid taking a wrong turn, killing his girlfriend, and then being like, I got to go to heaven, so I better be good.
Yeah, I got to go to heaven where we'll hang out again.
Yeah.
The leader of the pack. Yep. The leader of the pack, and then he gets run over by a car.
Yeah.
Now I'm sorry I fell for the leader of the... Brum, brum. There was the only song with a motorcycle sound in it.
Or just Ain't No Mountain High Enough, which was basically about how I'm going to find you.
Yeah.
There's nothing you do that will keep me.
A lot of stalkerish songs. The pedophile songs. Just a bevy of pedophilia going on.
Oh, you mean Jerry Lee
Lewis?
That
was more the 60s. But because there was, she was just 17, you know what I mean? And I think it was 16. Yeah, sweet 16. You're 16, you're beautiful, and you're mine, are you? Yeah. Really, Ringo?
You sure?
You want to go with that? 16? and then there's the other one, the young girl.
Oh, young girl, get out of my heart.
Remember? We go on home to your mama. Yeah.
I pulled you off your...
I'm sure she wonders where you are. It's like, what? Yeah.
The peak of the song is literally, you're much too young.
Yeah, yeah. That's the... You're much... Not your young girl. You're much too young girl.
Yeah.
Like he wants to really let you know this girl's 12.
Yeah, get out of my heart. I just pulled you out of your mom's shopping cart. You're much too younger.
When I look at your braces
and the painted faces you did with your fingers. Yeah, there were so many 60s and 50s, but even when you look at Jerry Lee Lewis, like Great Balls of Fire, you don't want the song to be ruined for you, but he's essentially talking about his dangerous penis.
His dangerous penis.
Yeah, because he was attracted to...
His pedophile penis.
His angry cock that wanted to marry his cousin. His 13-year-old cousin.
And Sweet Caroline was written about Caroline Kennedy, who was a child at the time.
Oh, that's right.
Yeah. And old Neil Diamond is like, what the fuck are you doing? what the fuck are you doing, Neil? And then he's got that other one, Girl, You'll Be a Woman Soon.
Oh, yeah.
That he wrote that.
Which is When I'll Ask You to Go.
Yeah. Girl, you'll be a woman in 15 years.
Or 15 minutes when I'm done with you.
Girl, you'll be a woman soon. You'll just have to come out of your mother's womb. I can't wait to touch your baby.
Then there was that song, Claire.
Oh,
remember we played that on our show, I believe, not too long ago.
No,
but
Claire is the ultimate in
Claire. The moment I met you, I swear, oh, I was so glad you had no pubic hair. All right, I shoehorned, but it's off the cuff.
It was just to know it was nice that your pussy was bare, but still, oh, natural, you didn't do it yourself. You're a little kid, Claire.
Claire.
Shit. My friend said I should fuck you on a dare. Claire. And Dancing Queen, Only 17. It's essentially about a girl who got into a disco underage, and now this man wants to fuck her.
And now a disco dude in his three-piece suit. You got that one? Yeah.
Yeah, this is Claire.
Look at the cover of the album. Yeah.
It's him and his girlfriend.
Yeah. He's like, he's chasing her around the yard.
It's like, wear that short dress with the hearts I like.
By the way, this isn't his kid. It's not supposed to be his daughter or anything. This is the creepiest fucking video and song.
Where is Gilbert O'Sullivan? Because we should beat the shit out of him.
Probably doing fucking 20. Yeah.
Oh, I don't think he's doing anything that old.
Look, her underwear is showing. Claire. I want to take off your underwear.
But it's a diaper, Claire. I want to change you and feed you.
I hope your parents don't notice how I stare. Where you have no hair.
I convinced me to let them babysit you. But you're the one who's doing the sitting today.
Jesus Christ. Oh, Claire. What a creep.
Oh, Claire.
That is a creepy-ass fucking video.
You're all the rave. Like they're the song was find you in a shallow grave. Oh, Claire. Semen-soaked child coffin. Sorry.
Claire. Like, the fucking song isn't bad enough. Like I'm sure every engineer that had to work on the board op and the guy that sets up the equipment in the studio is just watching it like we were watching fucking Howard sing his song yesterday. Just horrified. And then he's like, yeah, I want to make a video. Oh, yeah, some kind of interpretive thing where, you know, people understand Claire is your car or something. It's like, no, I want a little child running around in a dress that shows her underwear, and I'm pretty much making out with her.
Yeah, I
want
to have eight wardrobe changes, but never just use the same yard.
Right. I feel like a dime. Nothing means more to me than hearing you say, I'm going to marry you. Will you marry me, Uncle Ray? Will you marry me, Uncle Ray? Is he supposed to be our uncle? Wow.
It's weird.
That's so pretty goddamn creepy.
So what he's saying is he's playing around with the daughter, or the
niece.
And the idea there is, she's kind of in love with him the way that
she's asking for it.
Could I be? Yeah, that's what I mean. It's what she's wearing.
Yeah. She said, I want to marry you. And he's like, well, that's it. That's called consent.
Yep.
He's like, in my book.
He's like, it's like, look, I thought we were playing wedding, but she seemed really into it. So, long story short, there is cherry all over her crib.
Yeah.
What a fucking Wow, I thought it would be like a metaphoric thing, like made him feel young.
Right, something like that. But it's literally he wants to have sex with his young niece. Claire.
Boy, the 70s weren't good. We just let people get away with all kinds of stuff.
Yeah. I'm just thinking Claire. Lyrics that are really bad. Claire, I'm sorry I made your ass tear.
Claire, Claire, I want to take off your panties and then hit the hot tub like Roman Polanski. Claire,
Claire. Claire.
Vagina bear, Claire.
Your vagina's bare.
I want to see you, look you in the eye, as you say, where is my daddy, and cry, Claire.
Claire, you'll disgust me when you grow a pear. You know, we're tits. 'Cause she's a young kid.
I'd like to keep your breast right there, Claire.
Claire.
Boyish nipples on my niece. I can't wait till her parents leave so I can get a piece
of Claire. I'm going to bury you right there. I know it's not fair.
But I'll be masturbating there as long as I care to, Claire.
Claire, I'm sorry, but the police seem to care. I'm gonna bury you right there.
I thought I could turn myself in, but I'd rather just bury you next to him, him, and him. You're the first girl I've had.
Oh, Claire!
My yard is a cemetery. For children I want to marry.
I've done it before, you little fucking whore, oh, Claire.
3 feet deep, because you're half the size.
I know you're a kid, but you wanted it more than I did. Oh, Claire.
Speaking of size, could you say no to those thighs? They've been calling me since the day she was born.
Jesus so Christ.
I bought an ice cream truck because my niece I want to fuck.
Oh, shit. I forgot to bury your shoe. So cute, it's a size 2.
I think I'll jerk off in it twice tonight and then go out back and put it where it goes right. Oh, such good times. I'm gonna keep your pigtails in a shoebox so I can use it when I have a hard cock, Claire.
Claire. I sure enjoyed your cute smile. I hope they don't open a cold case file. I just have to say, I hate DNA. Oh, Claire. So, poor Claire.
I remember when I taught you to fly a kite. Now I hope my house has never seen a black light. Claire.
Oh, Claire.
Claire.
The moment I met you. Yeah, here's the... There's something I wanted to get to before the show ends today.
Oh, sure.
We had so much fun yesterday talking about that wonderful song, Claire.
Yes.
Claire. And it's just a horrible pedophile song that... Yeah. It always gets brought up when we talk about you're 16, you're beautiful, and you're mine.
Don't
and,
tell your parents I
young girl.
You
yeah, yeah. Yeah.
Sorry. I immediately have to.
Well, Chris Baldassano, a friend of mine, plays Modern Warfare with me. He brought up one and says, I've always wanted to get this one in when you guys talk about this. And I watched it last night. I remember the song. I did not remember the video, But this is another just, it starts with you're 16 years old. Oh, God. That's the first line in the song. The video is so creepy. I looked it up. This guy was 34 or something when he made this. So it's not like, you know, he's 20 and she's 16 or something like that. He's 34. It's a ghoul. And the girl in the video doesn't look like, oh, you're just 16 years old. And it's a metaphor for how young she seems. No. The girl in the video looks 16 years old. This is so creepy. Let her rip. Volume?
Jeez.
All right, first of all, hold on. All right, you got to rewind it. Get some volume and stuff. Here's him going to the house because he's got the balls to go to the house of a 16-year-old girl. Her fucking father, Bigfoot, comes to the door. He just wants to hang out. You know, live his life. And this douchebag 34-year-old man is coming for his high school daughter. No? Where's the fucking music? No.
No.
Oh. All right, hold on. Look at his face, too. He's just, he's got this look like he wanted to be, I think he wanted to be like 20 in the 80s.
Right.
But he's in his 30s. And I think this is 1980. So he's having kind of a tough time. It's sort of a Steve Perry sound to his voice, too.
This guy's just trying to celebrate Passover with his daughter.
Yeah. And this ghoul is coming to the door. Here we go.
Oh, no.
She's just 16 years old.
What?
Leave her alone.
Leave her alone.
They say.
Yeah, they do say that. It's the law, dummy.
Oh, my God.
Benny Mardones.
Oh my God.
Don't know what love is yet.
This is yacht rock.
But yeah.
I want you to know.
Now he's looking through a window. Look at this ghoul. Yeah, we all know this. Dude, but look at her. She doesn't look like, she's not like a model.
No, she's a child.
Like you would look and go, most of these videos, it would be Tawny Katane. And you'd be like, oh, she's supposed to be 16. Yeah. She looks like she's in her 20s. Or, and she, this is literally a 16-year-old girl.
She's just sitting there. Yeah. What is she doing? Playing with a thing that teaches her animal sounds?
She's got her speak and spell. And this ghoul is looking through a window.
Oh my God.
I love.
She doesn't even notice that this monster is outside.
That this pedo is fucking like gazing through her fucking window.
So he cut the sleeves off of his prison attire.
Yeah, he just broke out. Oh my God. All right, let's watch a little. Fuck.
The cow goes moo. The pedo goes.
I'll show you loving like you've never seen. Yeah, I bet. He's all pissed. Goes to a what they call a urinal now. A homeless urinal.
He goes to a disease spreader.
Yeah.
It's like having a dream.
Who's he calling?
Who's he calling?
Well, nobody.
He's calling his parole officer.
Just yeah. He's like, you can't do it. You're going to go right back.
Look, I'll lock you right the fuck back up.
That jail is a revolving door for people like you.
I just got a report you were looking through a girl's window.
True. Didn't the dad sing to you that she's 16? Oh, my God. He's so creepy.
Yeah. So now he's talking to someone on the phone. Measure it in years you'll spend in prison.
He's just, why is it night? Oh,
now he's,
I need a shovel.
Now he has a show on Compound Media. It's all green screen. What is this? Now what's he doing? Wait, what is he? What is he's in a flying phone booth?
He's a flying phone booth.
This video's retarded.
I hate the fact that I've liked this song.
Oh, the song is a guilty pleasure.
I never knew it was about that, though.
Oh,
I guess I never heard the first
words. Yeah, if you missed the first verse or line, you're fine.
Yeah, it's just...
Now, this is great. He comes into the little girl's room and puts a rug in there. This is what I'm going to wrap you in and dump you in the woods in. Get on in. I'm going to murder you.
We're going to fly away.
Can you believe this? Yes, literally, he's now going on a flying carpet with jail bait.
We're going to go to where the flying carpet originates, where it's totally legal to fuck you.
Yeah. He's like Aladdin. Only wants to put it in Aladdin.
Yeah.
Oh, my God. Oh, can you even? Look at him.
Oh, my God.
She's 16.
He's just daring her. He's like, you can get off at any time.
Yeah. Look at this stock footage of the Statue of Liberty.
Yeah.
What is this?
Because that's what it stands for.
They should play Apollo 11 footage where he's on the moon.
Yeah.
Look at that. He's making out with her.
Oh, no.
He's making out with her.
Oh, no.
It's over the BQE.
Oh, my God. Is it him now?
Benny Mardone. And I guess he still performs this song.
I'm sure.
Out on, because this is a one-hit wonder, I guess.
Well, yeah, but, he's still.
Oh, there he is. Yeah, that's him now. I wonder if he ups the age.
Yeah.
You're just 50 years old. Oh, 60. You're just 60 years old.
Yeah. Or it's lower. You're just 8 years old.
I'll show you an anti-arthritic drug like you've never seen.
Just drink this. Oh. I'm gonna use chloroform. We're gonna make a porn. And I
oh my God, it's
sell
so ghoulish.
It
like you never seen.
I imagine.
Show you love that you've never seen. She's never seen any love.
Yeah. Guys, like, look, she's a child. And he's like, all right, well, I'm gonna throw a magic carpet.
A magic carpet in there. I could fly somewhere, fuck her,
kill
her, roll her in the carpet.
Yeah.
Put her in a shallow grave. He's flying on the carpet with JonBenet Ramsey.
I'm just going to say it.
What a piece of shit. Benny Mardone's.
Are you going to put that in your trunk and drive roughly a mile from your house and throw it in the woods?
Yeah, it's like the fantasy. You know the fantasy in Wolf of Wall Street where he's driving and he's not crashing and everything?
Yeah.
Like, his fantasy is they're on the magic carpet and he's making out with her. And then it goes to the reality. It's just leaves in the woods and he's rolling her up in that carpet. Her fucking panties are all splayed out. She just fucking, her throat is...
Yeah.
Her eyes are all bloodshot from the fucking strangulation.
Yeah. Or the dad just kicks open the door and he's just holding this crying girl down, eating her out on a rug.
As the dad pulls out a Louisville slugger and caves his fuck head in.
That's his dream.
Right before he loses consciousness and life.
He's just, in a coma having...
That's the head injury dream he's having.
In a coma, handcuffed to a hospital.
Yeah, he's hearing a keyboard, but it fades into his heart monitor at the hospital. Beep, beep. You're just 15 years old. Benny Mark.
Oh my God.
Donis.
That is the, that's better than the Claire one.
Yeah, yeah. It's so ghoulish. And the fact that, like, the video, they didn't hey, Benny. I like the idea for the video. All cool. We got a few actresses lined up that are going to play the part of the girl. Here they are. And he's just like, no, they look like they're 20. I want, the line says, she was 16 years old. I want 16. Could it be like an older looking 16? No.
Why?
I want a stupid barrette in her hair.
Do you know that I based the whole song off of the first line?
Right.
When I put pen to paper and penis to paper.
When I put penis to...
When I put penis to carpet.
I want it done my way. You get me a 16-year-old girl.
Yeah. You get me a 16-year-old girl and parents who need money with a consent form, and we will shoot this video.
Because I actually make out with her in this video, by the way.
Yeah. There's a reason I need this to be authentic.
Just ghoulish.
Oh my God.
I can't get enough of some of the ideas people had for these videos. They're fantastic.
I just love that he's just like, all right, so I'm making out with her, and they're like, where does the flying carpet go? He's probably just like, I don't fucking, I don't know, Statue of Liberty?
Yeah. Like, do whatever. We have stock helicopter footage?
I don't know. Put something behind me. I'm making out with her, right?
I don't care if it's the fucking copter scene from Apocalypse Now. Yeah. We're over the Nam. Yeah, I'm over the Da Nang River.
Yeah, we accidentally started using the green screen when you're still at the phone booth. He's like, yeah. I don't really care.
Yeah. There was a brick wall behind you or something. I don't know. Eddie Murphy was performing in front of you. Yeah, it was the improv.
Yeah, I don't give a shit.
Whatever, as long as I get to make out with a 16-year-old.
By the way, I'm going to need 6 changes of pants, and I would like to shoot the scene from 80 different angles.
Right. I'm just going to look at her through a window. Can we do that scene where I'm literally a peeping Tom looking at a young girl doing her homework through a window?
Somehow she doesn't notice that there's a monster's eye like Jurassic Park 3 inches from her head. Yeah. You see a water glass move because of his hard dick?
Yeah. Her fucking Kool-Aid. Her little cup of Kool-Aid. In her Flintstones jelly jar is fucking rattling as his big boner comes up to the window. It's beyond creepy.
Oh my God.
It's beyond, but you know, I guess it was a different time.
I'm not going to attempt to top that.
I guess it was a different time. Ladies and gentlemen, I love watching any sports person try to be an actor.
Oh, it's the best.
It's like anti-acting. We used to make fun of it all the time. Even as kids, me and my brother and sister picked up on how bad sports stars were because they put them in TV series all the time, a little cameo guest appearance or something. You might have seen the Brady Bunch. And they used to love having baseball and football stars come on the Brady Bunch.
Oh, yeah.
And it's so bad. What was the one guy, Daryl something or fucking, I don't know.
Strawberry.
It was an L.A. Dodger.
He's just smoking
crack.
Way before
Strawberry's time. Yeah, yeah. Hey, Groovy, let's smoke some crack with Daryl Strawberry. And then maybe you could fuck your father in the ass.
Yeah. Then that was also on the show Elf, which I don't know if I'm pronouncing right. But did you know that about the dad on Elf?
Oh, he was a fucking crazy crackhead mo, right?
Yeah, like he loved black cock and crack. So
and
they found all these photos of him like in a crack house blowing dudes and smoking crack.
Yeah,
big
the Elf guy.
And the guy who wrote it was Jerry Stahl, who was a fucking huge heroin addict. He's a great author.
Geez.
He's sober now. Yeah, who knew that a heroin addict would write a show about an alien that eats cats?
Yeah, yeah, that makes sense now. That makes perfect sense.
Yeah.
Oh, no.
Is this it? Yeah.
Oh, yeah, there he is.
It was him and his lover.
He must have loved that Alf's nose looked like that. Maybe he told him. Like, hey, I want to redesign Alf.
Yeah. I want a dick with 2 urethras.
Alf's face was just regular flat face. And he came up and said, I got an idea for Alf. Let me draw it for you. Yeah. And just draws a fat fucking chode cock.
I want a cock so big it has rolls in it.
And I want so much cum in my face, I need 2 holes at the end for double the cum. Oh, look at this guy.
It's amazing because... even when they just busted that guy down in Florida and you see his room with all the pills.
Uh-huh.
And like, when you get caught, they really go all out. They never just catch you with crack. It's always shit like this.
Oh, my God. They're just sitting there naked smoking crack. He's like, wow.
And then he's got to go teach moral lessons to his family on television.
Yeah, yeah. Oh, wow. They're all degenerates, by the way. All the Hollywood thing. That's a whole nother thing that's been bubbling beneath the surface of the news for quite some time. And I'm not even talking, you know, the shit with Corey Feldman, because he's just a fucking carnival barker of pedophilia.
He's a piece
for Hollywood.
Of shit.
He's just a piece of shit. He's got new tweets out that he's re-releasing his stupid documentary, My Friend Got Pounded in the Ass, I think it's called. By Charlie Sheen.
They called the movie The Rape of Two Corys, which somehow couldn't be shown.
Yeah, yeah.
On several occasions.
Right.
And then they interview Corey Haim's mom, and she's like, I don't think Charlie Sheen fucked him.
Yeah, I don't think that happened. But, you know, Corey...
maybe.
Corey Feldman's giving it his all.
What's what I don't get is he's saying that about Corey Haim, where it's like, you hung out with Michael Jackson, Corey Feldman. Yeah.
When you were a kid, when you were the age that he would fuck you.
Right. Never even just, I don't know, held your hand for too long or
no.
sat too close to
Nothing.
You on his bed where he allows kids to jump around. Self-admitted.
While he sets up fucking tripwires for parents that might come in.
Bells.
Like it's Da Nang. He's fucking wiring bells. And
a series of bells because he's still five at heart.
What does this say? Oh, frontard enemy. Let me put this here.
You know what I like to do? I like to have 27 locks on my door.
Yeah.
And then when you go through that door, there's another door.
Yeah. This is my friend, Mr. Claymore. We're going to put him here. This is his girlfriend, Bouncing Betty.
Yeah.
We're going to put a couple here. If the parents come, they're going to lose their balls. Yeah, but he didn't do anything to not E.T., Gremlins age fucking Corey Feldman.
Yeah. Believe me, he did.
Of course. Of course he did.
He came in that bowl cut so many times.
It's so fucked up. Like, there's so much going on. Like you just said, with the fucking fat guy, is he dead? Is he not dead? And that, the pedophile thing. I just saw, like, everyone has been accused of pedophilia in Hollywood, from the greatest directors, Spielberg, to, America's dad, Tom Hanks.
Yeah, Shirley Temple's Hyman.
Yeah, Shirley Temple. I read stories where people back then in those Hollywood days with Shirley Temple would just outwardly say, Shirley Temple, you know, for a young child, she had a nice set of legs. Like there was something written about Shirley Temple's, the shape of her legs were womanly.
Oh, God.
For a six-year-old.
Well, yeah, probably because they beat her while she made her
right,
dance.
They were swollen.
Yeah.
You know, a little girl's leg swollen looks like an adult woman's leg.
It's a growing body, and you're making it dance up and down steps all day.
She looks like the midget from fucking Total Recall. Yeah, when you make her dance up and down the stores with a Negro all day.
Exactly.
Tap dance.
Mother says I shouldn't talk to these. No, no, you're going to dance.
No, go ahead.
You're fine. This is for a film.
And there's Shirley's mother. Yes, dear, talk to the Negro.
Go ahead. I want money. Afterwards, go to the producer's office. The head of Warner Pictures is going to fuck you. Can you imagine? Bent over a desk by Mr. Warner himself.
Yes.
God damn.
That's what it was. And that's what I think it still is. When you see like the Alf guy, like tell me that other people in Hollywood didn't know that was going on.
There's no way people on the set didn't know what was going
on. Yeah. They know what's going on. They don't say anything. And then when something like Weinstein happens, they all have to clamor and say, oh, we knew. And it's terrible. And, but then why didn't you do anything? Why didn't you say anything?
Well, and in Jerry Stahl's book, he's pretty brutally honest. It's called Permanent Midnight, about that experience. I don't remember if he mentions that at all, but he does talk about his own heroin addiction. But he was a writer for like all these magazines in Hollywood before he got that job. And he just talks about these people with their real names being pieces of shit. Like, just bless you.
I'm sorry.
COVID.
You know what it is? I gotta also tell people. It's a beautiful day in New York today.
It is.
The sun's out and the fucking pollen is flying.
I also maybe, I think I'm in a vacuum.
Yeah?
I don't know. Maybe it could be pollen coming in.
It could be pollen coming in.
My head feels like it's going to explode. I get it.
Yeah, I got like that pin up the nostril feeling.
Well, and it was also 9 degrees yesterday and today it's like 70.
Yeah.
They don't want to hear about that.
It's got to suck if you get a regular old cold right now.
Yeah, it's the
worst.
Because
then you're like, oh, no, this is it.
There's no way. And then you look, and it's not even the symptom. Because a lot of the symptoms are, they range from nothing to not that bad to dead. That's all there's no middle ground.
No, it's fucked up. You'll have some sniffles, maybe a little sore throat.
Yep.
And then by the time you get a fever, you might as well just start digging a hole out there.
Yes, you'll have a bit of a dry cough. And by dry cough, I mean dry coffin. It'll be made of wood.
It's very dry. They've run out of good wood because everyone's dying. Dry coffin.
It's so weird. There's just no answers.
And no answers. We don't know anything. So but we sit here and we're fucking under house arrest.
And I get what you mean by pulling down those clips. I feel like that happens when you're not supposed to know something. And then yesterday, the Pentagon just releases alien footage.
Oh, that's another thing that
like,
just
what
happened.
The fuck is this? Like, how are you distracting us? And it's so weird right now. You're not even shocked. You're like, yeah.
Look over here. Look over here. It's a flying saucer. It's crazy. Don't look over there.
Yeah, don't. We got to pull some clips down. Aliens.
Oh, no, the doctors were right about this. Pull the video down. People are getting mad. Oh, no, look, UFOs. Oh, shit. What do we got there? That's how they treat us. That's, this is fucking amazing. I love this shit.
We're going against the wind. The wind's 120 knots to the west. The whole thing, dude.
I just love how fighter pilots are calling each other dude. Yeah. They're all frat bros. Yo, dude.
I also love that this is the technology.
Yeah. It is moving. Like, it's rotating.
Oh, it's weird as shit.
And then this thing. I like this because he's trying to cap it. He's trying to get it. Track it. And it's going so fast. And when he finally gets it, he's all excited about himself like a video game.
Yeah.
God. He's like, "Well, got it." I understand that from playing video games.
Yeah. Now shoot.
And they're
it.
All laughing that he capped it, not the fact that it's some kind of fucking flying saucer.
Which makes me think they've seen a lot of this.
Yeah.
Shoot it.
They're laughing at it.
It's so weird.
Oh, pilots. Yeah, it is strange. Those were declassified. They had come out earlier. Leaked, as they say. And the Pentagon said, we don't know about this. We don't know anything, blah, blah, blah. Mm-hmm. So then yesterday, the Pentagon decided to put them out themselves and say, yes, these indeed are unknown to us. We don't know what they are. We've investigated it and still have no clue. People, and this again for years, and if I may bring up the Brady Bunch yet again.
Please.
UFOs are unidentified flying objects. UFOs do exist.
Of course.
Because they're things you don't know what they are. They're not necessarily alien things. And so many people write articles that say, do you believe in UFOs? Well, yeah, I believe there are things that are unidentified that have been flying around, that no one knows what they are. It doesn't mean they're flying saucers or alien things. It could be experimentation from our country or another country or whatever. But they still... do these articles where they say Pentagon admits to UFOs. And it's like, yeah, they admit they don't know what the fuck it is. Yeah. It doesn't mean it's a flying saucer.
They admit that they couldn't identify what very well might be a swallow.
Right. It doesn't. Yeah. And in the Brady Bunch, they had a UFO and it was just Greg. Greg was using a whistle and a projector on a plastic screen and going, woo.
What if they...
Yeah.
They just open it up. It's just Mork with a noose around his neck.
Nanu. He didn't know. Greg was doing it, and he was trying to fool Bobby, and Bobby had a dream that he was going into a UFO, and it was his father's ass. Because you can't talk about the Brady Bunch without talking about a flaming Mo. Well, Mike Brady was.
And then, of course, back to the dad from Elf.
Right, dad from Elf.
He kept the alien so he could use its fucking its penis mouth on him when all his kids were asleep.
He could fucking sodomize himself with that schnozola.
That's why he's eating cats. Just wanted to get the flavor out of his mouth.
Oh, my God.
Hey, you know what your dad does? He fucks me at night.
Hey.
What?
And yeah, there was like a kid on the show and everything.
Yeah, it was like best friends with a kid. There was an episode. It is the weirdest episode of television ever. I was tripping my balls off on acid when I first saw it, so I had to go back to see if it was
Perhaps
real.
Perhaps that's why it's the weirdest episode.
But it's him and it's Elf, and Elf eats the couch, and it turns out Cotton gets him high.
Oh.
So he's up all night singing New York, New York with a top hat on because he's just lit. The next day, the dad goes off on him about his drug addiction.
Oh, Jesus.
And he goes, here's some aspirin, and he slams it down. And as he turns around, Elf sneaks the cotton out of the aspirin and eats it, and the dad goes fucking apeshit.
That's really funny.
Yeah, and when I was watching it, though, tripping, I'm like, is this real? Like, I'm looking at all my friends, and like, this is happening, right?
This isn't, like, this isn't me.
I couldn't believe that this was, because the guy is furious, screaming at Elf about his addictions. And then,
You know, projection makes for great acting.
Oh, dude, he was talking to himself.
There what are like, you sucking that big black cock for?
He's like, wait, what?
Oh, wait, cut. Where did that come from? Where did?
Why do you keep calling the cushions he ate ass pillows? But yeah, I went and I looked at it, and yeah, I was like, oh shit, it was real. And then that's when I found the article that he just showed. And this was years ago, where I'm like, oh my God, this guy's a monster.
This guy's a fucking monster. Yeah, and then he's working on a daily basis with a child with this kind of proclivity to fucking debaucherous sexual and drug.
I feel like there's such a stepladder, too, because when, and I say this is a drug addict, you know, like, there's this stepladder where your behavior goes so far. Like, he did a lot of shit before getting to, like, photography and cocksucking and crack. Like, there's a lot of steps.
You don't start that whole journey in life with the camera and the crack pipe and the naked black guy.
Nobody's first drug experience is hiring a naked black guy, sucking his dick while smoking pot, and then having smoking crack, and then having it be a gateway to weed.
No. You work yourself into that.
Right.
You might start smoking a joint while masturbating to Gary Coleman.
Yeah, that might be a first.
Like, you start that way. A little more personalized.
Your proclivities might be weird.
Right.
But they're not shameful and career ruining.
Yeah, you don't bolt right into that.
If people have asked me if I think marijuana is a gateway drug, and it's like, yeah, but I don't think it's bad because a lot of people can not do stuff past it.
Yeah.
But for me and a lot of people, yeah, if you get high once, you're going to be like, oh, I wonder what's next, what's next, what's next. And for people like that, that's who doesn't work out so well for.
I don't know if marijuana is so much a gateway drug as it's just a drug.
That's more acceptable.
Like, if you take weed out of the mix, I think you'd still have as many cokeheads and crackheads and methheads and people doing other things. I think they'd start with that. I think it's just such a logical starter drug. Everyone can smoke weed. I don't think everyone is going to go on to the next thing. I think the people that do go on to the next thing would have anyway if there wasn't any such thing as weed. You know, I just don't see it like that.
Yeah.
It starts people on that road. I guess it can, but I don't think it's a percentage of people as they want to make you think when they were doing that dragnet kind of. It's a gateway drug.
I don't really believe, I guess I should say so much that it's a gateway drug, but at one time, people were pretty afraid of drugs.
Oh,
and that was the first one that people would do.
Television.
Yeah, and that would lead to, you know, more, I shouldn't say normal, but more normal drugs, like LSD, mushrooms, whatever.
Right.
It was a psychedelic experience. It was something more artistic than it was a drug.
I think it justified it more.
Yeah,
like, you could smoke a joint, and it didn't have the stigma on it as coke or heroin, especially, or anything like that. But once you smoked weed, then you realize, oh, I could just go to the next thing.
Right.
Like, I get that, but I know a lot of people that only smoked weed and never.
Oh, me too.
More so than went on to other things, I think.
Well, and I think making it legal is what's going to benefit that, because all of a sudden it stops being on an equal playing field with heroin.
With all the other shit.
Yeah, which is what I think the problem with it was to begin with, was ever outlawing it.
Yeah.
And then you go from, and now I guess, I think the playing field has changed, I guess, is a good point you've made, because now you have opiates and this shit that was prescribed to some people who have never even smoked weed, and now they're a heroin addict.
It's as far as drugs are concerned, to me, the biggest thing that has happened in the course of even 20 years is the acceptability of heroin.
Oh yeah.
Like growing up, of course, weed in the 80s, coke, did some meth, did some LSD, some mushrooms, some fucking mescaline, all that shit, tough guy. But the line between all that and heroin was a chasm. Like, you never fucking crossed that line. And within 20 years, heroin became as acceptable as, you know, a fucking Valium.
Yeah.
Or shit. And that's, to me, really turned the tide of why we see so many young people dropping dead of opiate overdoses.
Well, and there is prescription heroin. It's just under different names, yeah. Obviously, Oxy. And then you have essentially stuff that's prescription cocaine, which is, you know, for ADD. Like, that'll make you focus.
Yeah, Adderall. Keep you up for what is it?
Adderall. Well, there's different versions of it, and then there's others that's more potent. So you have that available to people. And even when I was a kid, I remember the first time people got Adderall for focusing.
Yeah.
They all of a sudden also had hyperactivity disorder.
Yeah, of course.
It's like, yeah, you're giving a six-year-old
coke. You're
giving
them speed. What are you doing? Of course.
So basically, you're now cutting it with a Xanax. And now you're wondering why he's dead at 16. Well, I'll tell you why.
Yeah.
Because you wanted him to focus.
It's the same thing. Oh, I got sneezing out.
Oh, heavens.
You motherfucker.
Bless you.
We talked about how they're prescribed. They're prescribing too much to too many people. Hence the heroin thing. They started prescribing pain medication that was heroin, prescription heroin. When that became too expensive, people went out on the street and got heroin. So again, the legal pharmaceutical industry wound up fucking this country over with getting people addicted to a drug that they then didn't even have control of, street heroin. I mean, where's the plus side in that?
And it's come to the point where China produces the drug. All these other countries produce the drug where we get it.
China,
it's not
again,
just America.
You.
Yeah. And then you had people making their own pills. And then you had people, you know, and now heroin. And I've lost so many friends to heroin. And when we were young, it was because they didn't know what they were doing.
Right.
You inject a drug for the first
time.
That
was right. That was when you heard someone die. They OD'd. They took too much. They did it wrong. They fucking. Yeah, that's what you heard. And then you just heard, no, it's just if you take it, you'll die. Or maybe you won't.
Yeah, now with fentanyl, which is like super heroin, they're like, I don't know. Good luck to you.
Yeah.
And the good news is if you live, it'll feel real good.
Yeah. Isn't that fucking amazing?
I just don't.
Yeah.
And I get it because you're addicted. And
right.
It's so easy to get addicted to pills and shit, especially if a doctor's saying you need this.
Yeah, yeah.
And then one day he goes, you don't need it anymore. And you're like, so what do I
do? No, I need it.
Yeah, I don't want to have a seizure from withdrawal.
Yeah, go suck a black guy's cock. Get yourself a stuffed alpha animal and go at it, my friend.
Take it to town. You're going to be fine.
You know, I think the Goonies, all the Goonie people, got together for a Zoom meeting.
Oh.
Kind of a reunion. Could you pop that up? I think, and it was. No, I didn't send you shit.
Sorry.
I didn't send you shit. No, I know. Yeah, it's fine. You can find it eventually, I'm sure. And it's weird because Corey Feldman is part of it and Steven Spielberg is part of it. And Steven Spielberg has been, all right, the accusations are a little far-fetched, but with what we've seen in Hollywood, Alf guy, nothing is out of the realm of possibility. And I've heard things about, you know, the girl that was in Poltergeist.
Yeah. Well, she died of impacted bowels.
Yeah, what's her name? Heather O'Rourke.
Yeah.
And she died, yeah, of a digestive, a bowel problem.
Right.
And the accusations are that she was fucking rented out to these Hollywood executives that destroyed her insides by raping her. And she died. And Spielberg was supposedly part of that.
Yeah, or at least aware of it.
Or aware of it,
and
right.
This was, I know Spielberg produced this, had a big hand in casting. I know Richard Donner directed, but who knows if that was to take his hands off of it, you know, at the time.
Right. Yeah, just a lot of weird shit.
So and then, I hope he's not. I really do, because I like him so much.
That has to go into the Michael Jackson category of, you know, if bad comes on the radio, I'm still listening
exactly,
to
it. Yeah. I'm not going to turn off Jaws.
I ain't turning it off. I ain't turning off fucking Jaws. I ain't turning off Close Encounters, motherfucker. I'm watching that shit.
Although, now that we say the titles of his movies, I'm starting to think maybe.
Close Encounters.
Jaws.
I do believe, you know, if I hear, you know, hey, I'll turn it off and go, ah, you fucking freak, motherfucker. But, you know, Schindler's List, I'm watching it.
I'm going to watch it.
One of the greatest Another comedies
one.
Ever made.
A secret list.
Schindler's. Schindler's Secret? List. Should we call it Schindler's Secret? I don't know. It was secret from the Nazis. Yeah, but it was more a list. Yeah. I don't know.
Should we redo your script to maybe make this take place during World War II?
Yeah, the little girl yelling goodbye Jews in 1989 New York.
Just seemed odd. It just seems odd that the next scene you get to have sex with her because she was so rude. We should probably cut that out of the film.
Yeah, maybe that. Like, I'm not going to watch Saving Private Ryan because of things he might have done.
Yeah, could maybe the kid's asshole be the beaches of Normandy? Yeah. Because by the way you've described it.
Yeah, the way you've described this. Can we set this in World War II
again?
And maybe have the invasion of Normandy beach? That would explain all the blood you have here on page 16. Where the child is involved and it's a pillow.
You've already called it the invasion of Norm. Yeah. You really just have to add a couple letters.
Right, and his sister D. Norm and D get invaded and there's a lot of blood.
Let's just put it all together.
Add some soldiers. People will watch this without being too horrified. Not as horrified as your original draft.
Well, it's also like It's also Stephen King, who's
he's another one.
Yeah, where he's had this insane amount of sexual misconduct with kids in his books. Yeah. And even in the movie It, me and McLowry once did a sketch about it somewhere online, but I'm interviewing him. And McLowry's great because he's Aspergery. So,
he's fucking great,
man. Oh, he's so funny. And he's playing Stephen King. And I'm like, I like the book. I just, before we let it out, I'd like to talk about the group orgy of children you have in the middle of the book. And he's like, yeah, well, it's supposed to just express kids growing up, and that's
right,
the moment
it's
of
a
transition.
Certain loss of innocence.
And... yeah. I'm like, but couldn't it be kids not having sex with each other? And he's like, I'm just not seeing the problem here. And then we ended with it just with like a Larry David song of just him like this.
Bum, bum, bum. Which, by the way, is the greatest song for the end of a fucking meme
anything
I've ever seen in my life. It works every time.
Every single time is the best way to end.
Every single time.
And I never read it. I read part of it, you know, and then I looked at it years ago and I was like, wow, this is fucking disgusting. Like, he's seriously a disgusting man.
There's always, every fucking thing he writes has a child or children in a horrible situation.
Mm-hmm.
And there is a sexual aspect to a lot of it. Even The Shining, where you see young Danny supposedly sexually assaulted. I think that was supposed to be what happened to him when he went into the room at the Overlook, the room 22 what?
Yeah.
Room 227. No, that was a TV show.
I love that show. It's just a bunch of people on the porch being sassy.
Yeah, a lot of
Yeah. Jack Hay just walks up.
Jack Hay. Now listen, Jack Hay. I'm Jack Nicholson.
Jack Hay's the bartender.
Jack Hay. Your money no good here, Miss Torrance.
You've been here all the time.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Jack Hay, see ladybugs.
You've always been the caretaker, Miss Torrance. Jack Hay. Oh, my God.
So funny. But I think you're right, and Stanley Kubrick, I have a feeling, scooted over that.
Yeah.
And probably got in an argument with him about
That's
it.
That's probably why Stephen King didn't like it. There wasn't enough child sex the fucking movie.
He's like, what do you mean he just looks at the twin ghosts? No, he just sees them in the hallway. He's like, you have three kids and there's not an orgy?
Yeah. Aren't there supposed to... I don't know. Isn't young Danny supposed to correct my two daughters? They had to be corrected.
Why is his asshole an elevator of blood? You realize that was a metaphor in the book. I'm seeing a screen here.
I think you fucked your whole family, Grady.
I hate Stephen King.
Oh, fuck Stephen King. Fuck him in the ass. Oh,
I even tried. I watched that new show, too, The Outsider, because I heard it was good.
Yeah.
And it wasn't.
It wasn't. There's, I don't know.
By the end of it, I'm like, yeah, like the first two that, why am I blanking on his name? A guy from Ozark.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, that guy. On
Jason Bateman. The first two he wrote and directed, I'm like, oh, this is great. And then he was out of it, and you're like, I didn't mean to ruin that, but... I ruined so much shit on him.
Then, you know, he dies.
So he dies.
No one wanted to watch it anyway.
No,
terrible.
Yeah, and I just watched it because I wanted to see it through to the end, and I'm just not doing that anymore.
Yeah, yeah.
There's too much content for me to keep wasting my fucking time.
No
praying
shit.
For a new show or situation show, drama, whatever.
Yeah,
funny.
You ever do that? You binge something, and then halfway through, you're like, motherfucker, I think I wasted 8 days. I wasted a week. Like, because I don't give a fuck. I don't want to watch. There was a, what the fuck was the Stephen King series where the guy goes back in time with JFK, the assassination? That was Stephen King, right?
I think so. I think it was.
Yeah.
Fuck, I know what you're talking about.
Who was the guy? Because he was.
I'm trying to remember if it was Stephen. I think it was Stephen King.
I think it was Stephen King.
What is it?
What's that? 11/22/63. Yes.
11/22/63. Was that Stephen King? Okay.
Yeah, it's Stephen King.
Was there a movie that they called? Was it a different name for the series?
No,
though?
I think it was the same name for the 11/22/63. Yeah, yeah, and I watched it because first of all, with time travel shit and me, you really gotta fuck it up for me not to like it. I just dig that whole fucking genre. Any kind of time travel and shit, trying to affect the future by doing something in the past or the present. Is great. So I'm watching this, and it turns out to just be awful. And it was the fucked up thing is, it's compelling enough at the beginning to rope you in because you're waiting for something to happen. Oh, right, he was in it.
Yeah.
What's his name?
James. Yeah.
It's not his brother. It's
fucking Franco.
Franco.
Thank you, Drew.
Who, by the way, I really am not a fan of in most things.
No, he's good in some things.
Some things he's really good. I liked him in that stupid Western thing he did. That goof from was it the Farrelly brothers or the other brothers? It was the same guys that did Fargo. I love when we go 18 deep into our fucking things going on here.
It was a Coen Brothers movie, but I'm trying
brothers,
to think
right.
of the name. Yeah.
It was Coen Brothers. It was like that fucking guitar playing on the horse guy.
Yeah.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. Yeah, he was good in that. Like, he had a segment. It was a segment of part of the movie, and it was
he's
good
in
good.
This Is the End, because he just plays a piece of shit.
Yeah,
then,
piece of shit, which they all are, whole group of guys.
That's what I thought was funny. People didn't like it. I just loved how they were all garbage.
It's
and
like,
then,
this is exactly what they'd be like. Yeah, they're pieces of shit.
And Danny McBride's the worst one.
Oh!
He has the best intro to any character in that movie where he's just laying in the bathtub and it's smoke rings. And then he just comes out and washes his feet with their remaining bottled water and is just eating all their Eggos. It's like, I made you breakfast.
Danny McBride is fucking great.
He's really
funny. Very funny. And I think out of the whole asshole thing, like, I don't know why, but he's likable.
Dude, that is the best
intro. Oh, is that great?
Just this complete douchebag. It's just a great parody of himself. Because he's quite Kenny Powers. He's more unlikable playing himself.
Yes! He's more unlikable as himself.
And I like his story because he sort of... Dude, this is just...
Oh, so
it's the
good.
Best song. It's the best intro.
Yeah.
Just smoking weed, eating all their food, not giving a shit.
The reveal.
He's too. He was blacked out, so he doesn't even know there's an apocalypse. Or that the rapture's happening. And I love that's the idea, is all the good people have gone to heaven, so all these movie stars are stuck here.
Are just shit. Yeah. The rapture has happened, and what's left of these douchebags?
Yeah, and this is all the food they have, and he's just making them breakfast.
And he's just binging on their rations.
So fucking good.
God, is that good.
Yeah, and so people hated it, but I love that
No, I
movie.
Like that.
There's a part where... Fucking, what's why am I what's his name today? I'm usually so good.
We're
at
all
this.
What's his name today? Yeah.
The not Seth Rogen. The fatter, younger.
Oh yeah,
Jonah Hill.
Jonah Hill.
I got it. But Jonah Hill he gets fucked by a demon. Yeah. Like all you see is the silhouette of this big demon cock and him screaming.
And you're going to get fucked by a demon in this part. Yeah. Like, oh, okay, great.
Fucking Craig Robinson steps on Aziz Ansari's hand, so he falls into hell, and then he comes, and he's like, I tried to save Aziz.
Yeah, it's all them just being assholes.
Yeah, they're just garbage people. It's so shit. Funny to me.
We're kind of seeing that now, aren't
oh,
we?
Oh, yeah. That's why I like Danny McBride's story. He made an indie film after not making it in Hollywood that Will Ferrell saw, and then he got, you know,
is that fucking, which one
Foot
is that?
Fist Way.
Yeah.
It's great. It's so funny, dude.
Yeah, that's a fucking good one.
So he wasn't like a young star. He kind of just, not like really late, but he made it later. So he's a more grounded guy, it seems.
Right.
You know, he's more appreciative of what he has. And yeah, because he didn't make it, so he went and made this film, and Will Ferrell saw it, and that's how he ended up getting the Kenny Powers role.
Wow.
So yeah, it's
yeah,
pretty cool.
Yeah, that's fucking awesome.
But yeah, Foot Fist Way is a great indie film.
Yeah, yeah. Like that one, too.
Yeah.
He's good, man. Anything he's in is
And I watched that
really
Arizona
funny.
Movie, and I thought it was good.
Crazy fucking movie.
Because his menacing is fucking that.
Yeah, it's so funny because it's a comedy that's really brutal.
Yeah, it's very...
You know, it's fucking... I laughed my ass off and then realized how awful I was laughing at some of the shit that I found funny.
Because you feel for him to a degree.
Right, to a degree. Yeah. And he's just a... fucking terrible person.
Yeah, he lost everything investing in this shit complex in 2008 before the housing market crashed. What's weird too is how it's based on a true story.
Yeah,
you wonder how much, but you know it's real.
Right, how many people actually felt that way and wanted to do that after being fucked over.
Right, and you can only, and when you watch it, there's only certain people that can play a dickhead and have you like them through
like
the
film.
Yeah,
and that is an amazing thing to be able to pull off.
Yeah, people say he's one note, but it's like, I've seen different ranges of that note. You know,
and
he's good at what he does.
And that's something I've always found amazing is a character that is just despicable that you're pulling for, that you're just like, oh, come on.
Yeah, you still want him to win.
I want this fucking real murderous, disgusting piece of shit to make it in the end.
Yeah, because you feel bad. You're like, who am I going for now?
Yeah.
This girl who did nothing, who's tied up with this fucking monster who did lose everything, so he's just snapping. He's not,
yeah.
He's not really a bad guy. He just keeps fucking up.
There are so many things like that. Ozark was like that.
Oh, yeah.
Where, you know, again, everyone in it is a piece of shit. Much like The Sopranos was another thing where every character, you might be bamboozled when you first start watching The Sopranos. I get so jealous of people that go, hey, I just started watching The Sopranos. First episode today, Anthony. I know you've talked about it. I'm like, motherfucking lucky cocksucker.
Enjoy the
You
ride.
Get to enjoy it from the beginning like this. And when you watch that first time through, you'll see characters that are so sympathetic and you think they're noble or righteous or good people. And then the more you watch The Sopranos over and over again, you realize there's not one fucking person in the entire show ever that is good. They're all pieces of shit.
The closest one is Maltasanti's girlfriend, and she's still a piece of
shit. Oh, and she's a piece of shit. She loves... The thing is, the ones that seem like the innocent ones that are dragged into this love the lifestyle, and they know what it is. They know it involves murder. They know it's crime. They just love the money. She loved that Christopher gave her the club. She's fucking snorting coke and doing ecstasy.
Stripper.
And yeah, all that shit. So she's just a piece of shit too. She looks down on people that aren't in the life. All that stuff. They're all fucking pieces of shit. I always thought the most innocent guy in the whole thing was the poor fucking landscaper that got his arm broke. Like, that guy really fell into a thing. But again, he knew he was mowing mobsters' lawns. He knew it.
Well, yeah, and then I love that Steve Buscemi puts himself in for a season because he's great, and he's just a pile of garbage.
Like, oh, what an asshole he was.
He's like, I just want to get out of prison and be a masseuse. He's like, you want to be a what?
Yeah, yeah. I'm going to get my massage license. Are you?
It's like, what do you mean?
Yeah, after I beat this chink up, I'm going to blow all that.
Just kills the dude's son.
And he fucks it up so bad, he shoots that guy. Yeah, he shoots him in his fucking... and his stripper girl in the car, and then he limps away. He just fucks it up.
And acts like he didn't do it.
Yeah, Tony, you better not be lying to me.
Yeah. Oh, I loved him.
It's just great. Every so often, me and Missy will be scrolling through channels, and there's nothing on. We'll just go, is it time? Is it time? Yeah, it's time. Gotcha. We'll just fucking watch Sopranos.
But it is amazing how you say that, because there are very few series where everybody's a piece of shit.
Yeah.
And even with Ozark, to hang on, Jason Bateman's become kind of the guy who's trapped.
Yeah, yeah.
Because he didn't mean to get in that situation. His kids are also kind of trapped, but they're not really. Like, the son's pretty good. The daughter's starting to get a little, you know, you can see the power hungry.
Right.
The wife is a cunt. And now it's becoming where you're rooting for Jason Bateman. But, of course, he was laundering money for the cartel.
So
it's hard to really
sympathize. Power thing. It's a lot. Oddly enough, Ozark is a lot like Breaking Bad.
Mm-hmm.
The husband wants to take care of his family, and he's fucked. He knows he's pretty much a dead man. Like, that's kind of the scenario. So anything goes. Whatever it takes to save my family, that's what I'm going to do. The thing is, every step he took to save his family put his family in more danger. But it was justified under that umbrella of saving my family. So while I think he thought he was doing something good for his family, at this point in the series, even he can't be that delusional.
No, especially when he got better. Like, the end didn't justify the means. And they added that part where, okay, he should be a billionaire. He should have made all this money off his company that he sold for 10 grand. He has a lot of reasons to be bitter. He's a teacher. His son's handicapped. All that stuff. But then there's a point where once he kills somebody, you're kind of like, I don't really like this guy anymore.
All bets were off.
And then I love that Jesse was supposed to die in the first season, but he was so good, they're like, I think we got to keep him on, because you start rooting for Jesse because he's growing up, you know, and trying, you know, minus the shit movie they made about him. But I mean, just in
I don't consider that part of the canon.
They just forget it happened. But you see him grow up and suffer for all these things that he didn't really, he was just a druggie.
It is interesting to watch early on Breaking Bad, where the relationship between literally a teacher and a student, like, that was a weird, very, because Walter, of course, had all the power over the student.
Right.
That's how those relationships work. And to watch that change to a point where, I don't know, they were pretty equal in power as far as the two of them were concerned.
Well,
obviously,
eventually,
outside of it, he's, you know, the big drug dealer guy. But,
oh, yeah, but eventually it became where Jesse was even more powerful.
I mean,
he became a monster.
Yep.
And that's why that's what I liked about the ending, was he dies with his machine. He's a monster who dies with his monster.
Yeah.
And that's what he deserved.
Yeah.
You know,
that was really good. And again, Walter is just a piece of shit.
Right. And his wife was this piece of shit fucking around on him, but she thinks she's better. Her name's Skylar, to just make you hate her more.
Skylar.
And then
I'm going to die.
Yeah. And so you just feel horrible.
No, Dad. I'm going to the car wash, Dad.
And the son, too, is accepting fucking, you know, I think it was a Dodge Charger his dad buys.
Right.
You know,
he fucking buys off some like retarded son with a car.
Yeah, some $50,000 car that he's, and that he'll take it then. But, you know, as he goes a little bit more, he's conflicted. But you go,
walking bed. I never saw that one. How did I miss that?
That's hilarious.
Fuck, is that funny?
You know, instead of making meth, he probably could have just came up with a cure for his son's ailment and yeah, fixed everything. He's like, I can make the greatest meth ever. Can you make medicine to help old...
Help your fucking gimpy son.
Help old clubby feet walk.
An old fucking cow tongue. Maybe you could shrink that tongue down. A comedy is another thing where if you get a group of people that are just horrible people, it doesn't seem like it would work, but Seinfeld is a great example of that. There is not anyone with a redeeming quality in that show. They are all pieces of shit, self-centered, narcissistic fucking assholes, and it's hilarious. I don't know how that works either, but...
Well, and I never realized this until recently because I watched it as a kid, but Saved by the Bell is actually all pieces of shit kids. And it's... Zach Morris is doing anything he can to scam people. AC Slater is just a rip guy who wants to bully everybody. Screech,
especially
just,
toenail fungus.
Exactly. Screech hates wants to be hated. Screech just wants to be liked, but he's willing to do anything and sacrifice himself for because he's such a weak person. Kelly just does anything to be liked and, you know, get attention. The other one, fuck, what's her name? Elizabeth Berkley.
Right, Berkley.
Jesse. Yeah, she'll fucking take pills to stay awake and do anything she can for that awful I'm So Excited episode just so she can get into a fucking Stanford or whatever.
Wasn't it supposed to be under the guise of youthful ignorance or something?
It was, but then
like they're trying to sort things out in their young lives.
Yeah, but then you have Lisa, who's this rich girl who doesn't give a fuck about poor people, and then Mr. Belding, who's just this pathetic asshole trying to make the school look like it's better than it is.
Didn't he get caught smoking crack with naked black guys? I don't know.
He had a thing where he did do some weird movies.
Really?
Yeah, he did some. Like he was on West Wing, and they tried to put him in other. You can't put Mr. Belding in other shit.
Yeah,
I saw an ad with him. He's like, that's an interview with him, and he's like, I'm on West Wing now. It's why I grew the mustache to separate from my other.
He's just typecast, it's right?
Like, no, you're Mr. Belding.
Isn't that terrible? Like some people get typecast, they don't realize they're typecast. And then once you realize it, it's too late.
Oh, you're
there,
done.
There was a great example of that was Fred Gwynne. Fred Gwynne, of course, was Herman Munster on the Munsters. Now, Fred Gwynne is a really good actor. He was a really good actor.
Up that road.
Yeah, yeah. He got on the Munsters. He had done stuff before the Munsters. He was on Car 54, Where Are You? Comedies and things like that. But
yeah, like The Judge and My Cousin Vinny many years later.
But that was what it took. It took so many years after the Munsters. No one would cast fucking Fred Gwynne because you'd see him and go, oh, that's fucking Herman from the Munsters. I'm not putting him in my movie. Everyone's going to see him and go, that's Herman from the Munsters.
Right.
So he does Pet Sematary and people go, wow, Herman from the Munsters was really good in Pet Sematary. And then he does My Cousin Vinny as the judge, and you got away from the Herman Munster thing.
You don't even see it.
That's fucking, that judge is really good. And then his final act of dying really fucked that up. Like he could have recaptured a great acting career as an elder statesman of Hollywood, overcoming that typecasting of Herman Munster, but he died.
He did.
There's just no justice.
Well,
man.
And I think what's interesting about that is the shittier the series, like the more ridiculous, the easier it's going to be to be typecast because nobody.
You think Gilligan ever got another fucking job after Gilligan's Island?
Well, look at Bob Crane.
Yeah,
from Hogan's Heroes.
Yes.
He had his fucking head bashed in. That's all he was
head
doing. Was
bashed apart.
There was blood everywhere. He's making sex videos.
Someone took a tripod while I was fucking a girl and bashed my head in.
Oh. His name was John Carpenter, but not the director.
I'm fascinated. After all the talk yesterday of child sexual predators and everything, you've worn your Punky Brewster shirt.
It says Holy Macanoli.
Is that what she used to say? Was that her catchphrase?
That was her catchphrase, was Holy Macanoli.
Like what you talking about, Willis and Dynamite.
Yep.
She had Holy Macanoli.
Holy Macanoli.
Is this true? Do we have a clip of little
Not the giant-titted monster she turned into.
Yes. Not the
Lil Punky Brewster saying, holy macanoli.
A young, what is her name? Les Moon? No, that's not it.
Moonface.
Moonface.
Soleil Moonfry.
Soleil Moonfry, that's it.
Right.
There's also Les Moonves.
Les Moonves.
Who's a sexual predator.
Right.
And then there's Soleil Moonfry.
Imagine Les Moonves just knocking around Soleil Moonfry's giant, big, fucking tits.
Oh, I think the guy who adopted her definitely.
Oh yeah, yeah.
Definitely was knocking those around.
Oh, Punky, let me see those giant tits of yours, Punky.
Oh, Punky, let me put your hair up in pigtails so I can fuck your face.
Yes, I'll hold on to your pigtails like handlebars, Punky, while you suck my unclipped British cock.
Punky, I want you to swallow, and then I want you to make eye contact with me and say, holy macanoli, as cum runs out of your mouth.
And we're a minute into the show. There we are. A minute in, and we're fucking Punky Bruce.
Yes. If you go to the phone, Punky, I will beat you to death with it and fuck your lifeless big-tittied corpse.
Look, Punky, I've brought you a kitten. Isn't it cute? You wouldn't like me to hurt the kitten. No. Punky.
Oh, Punky, I've spilled some paint on your shirt. We'll have to wash it and take a picture to commemorate the day I spilled the paint, Punky.
Oh, I seem to have shot macanoli all over your face. Where's a towel to clean up all that creamy macanoli?
I went down to the orphanage and I just said, give me a girl. About 3 feet tall. They let me have it. She's spry. She roller skates around the house. But she knows not to roller skate away from me.
I asked for a midget with a flat head so I could rest my beer upon it. But they gave me Punky.
The second time.
Use one of the bandanas she had wrapped around her leg.
Right,
oh, yeah.
The bandana on her leg. That's it's now called a cum rag, Punky.
It will be a tourniquet if you ever try to walk again away from me.
Ever hear of JonBenet Ramsey?
I will put you in my wall like I did the others, Punky.
All right, let's see her say a holy macanoli.
You got a holy macanoli?
I do not. I've been looking the whole time.
Wow.
Oh, they got a holy macanoli catchphrase.
What is this, Halloween? I'm sure it's terrible. What is that little Jap kid doing in whiteface?
Is their teacher Keith David? Hey, Punky, I didn't just take it out for air.
What is that?
This is when the Challenger exploded.
What?
Seriously?
But it's like a retrospective about it.
Launching with a teacher on board.
I'm going to bring my television and we can all watch the launch together. Would you like that?
Oh no, they actually did a special episode.
I've got a bad feeling about this.
We were watching the space shuttle take off.
Put your hand lower.
Yes.
What's happened, Punky?
It exploded.
Like my penis when I put it only 1 inch inside you. Just 1 inch.
If I break your hymen, Punky, they'll know.
Learn from the best.
The fuck kind of question is that, Henry? He tries to see for himself, but Punky
he doesn't
says,
know the shuttle exploded.
No, she hates reruns. Punky says the class counted down to launch and cheered, then stopped cheering 73 seconds.
Do you know what goes good on freckles, Punky? My macanoli. My penis macanoli.
They found out the macanoli rings were frozen.
You
should have let them thaw before launch.
Connect the dots.
And also the TV writers who will be asked to tackle this tomorrow. Punky demands
I'm going
answers.
To rub your clit Why? With my giant eyebrows, Punky.
Why, Punky? Well, it was a financial thing. They should have held the launch, but they knew that funding would be cut and needed to put a teacher in space because people were losing interest.
Punky, why do you have a black teacher?
I guess we don't have to worry about you ever going into space, right? Oh. Look, no black student.
He was on...
Hey, that girl.
This dude was on...
what was that show? It was Saved by the Bell when it was Good Morning, Miss Bliss. He was
on. Oh, really?
Show. Yeah, and I think he was on Sinbad show,
wow.
too.
Wow. Oh, there's a black kid. That girl is the sister of some other girl that's been in, I think, the anorexic one. Isn't she the twin sister of the anorexic one?
Oh, yeah. She the blonde girl was on Benson.
Benson, and the
and
other
her
one
sister
was
on Growing Pains.
Growing
Gold.
Pains.
Yeah, I don't know her name, but the anorexic sister was Tracy Gold.
Tracy Gold, right.
Oh, yeah.
Missy Gold. Missy Gold and Tracy Gold, the Gold sisters. One was fat, and the other one didn't have an eating disorder. I'm trying to get her to have an eating disorder.
This he's about to pull out.
Oh, no, Buzz Aldrin. Let me hear this. Buzz is batshit nuts.
Oh, yeah.
I love him.
He punches her for...
yeah, Punky. Hey, Buzz, I don't think you went to the moon. Fuck you, Punky. Punches her in the fucking face. Buzz gets Punky a young astronaut shirt. He's been known to.
Maybe that's where he got all his girl jewelry from.
Yeah. Buzz, how did we get to the moon in 1969 with so much less technology than the shuttle, but the shuttle blew up? Well, it's all bureaucratic bullshit, Punky.
Plan to blast off on all her haters. So what did we learn today? Be careful what you wish for. Because if you wish to one day be an astronaut, you might see a spaceship explode before the next
My rocket
break.
Ship is going to go into your crater now.
Sometimes good people explode.
The eagle has landed and ejaculated.
What a nice erect rocket on your shirt, Punky. Take it off.
I love how Buzz is old in this. Oh, yeah. He's 60 years old now. How old is Buzz Aldrin?
What is his name? George Hayes? I forget his name.
Oh, that guy there. Yeah. Old guy. Punky.
It was Punky.
George very Gaines. Special
what
episode.
Is it?
George Gaines.
George Gaines,
he was
yeah.
also Commandant Eric LaSalle.
Sorry, yeah, from Police Academy.
Oh, right. That's where I remember him from.
He always got his goldfish cooked.
Yeah.
Come hither, Tackleberry.
Yes.
That was...
Tackleberry. I'll tackle your
Tackleberry,
berries.
Tackleberry, yes.
Earl Mahoney.
That's where he was from. But he, the special episodes were awesome. And boy, did they whip that one up fast.
Oh, yeah.
There's a Punky Brewster special episode where her friend is playing hide and seek. Like, they have a junkyard because they're in inner city.
Yeah.
And gets locked in a refrigerator and suffocates.
Seriously?
Yeah.
Life imitates
her
art because that happened
Sherry
a couple years
Cherry?
Ago.
Why is E-Rock talking about this when we will... we're absolutely going to watch it.
Of course.
I mean, let's be real here.
Yeah. She hides in a refrigerator and they found her just in time as she passed out in the fridge.
Oh, she did.
Oh, really?
Does George is that the Cramden refrigerator? Jesus.
Does George Gaines come in to give her mouth to mouth? I'll save her. Then I'll save you.
Keep shelving.
This is the fan remix. We got to find another one.
Oh my God.
How many?
Again, the Indian from Washington D.C. comes in to fix it. That's all he did. Fucking fraud. Chief Fraud Eagle. He's there banging on it. I hear small child inside.
I know what will fix this. Make child live again.
Yes, we will get medicine man.
To rain dance. To keep white man away.
Why refrigerators that have been off for a while all smell same? Never understood that. Why you turn off refrigerator, open next day, always smell them exactly like other refrigerator you turn them off. Very strange. Must smoke them pipe in under this.
What's interesting is how no one checked that fridge for a game of hide and seek.
Yeah.
It's
yeah.
a fridge just sitting there amongst nothing.
Amongst nothing. It's just in the middle
it's
of nothing.
Out there for the collection.
Yeah. By the way, garbage. We've known, dude, you're supposed to take the doors off refrigerators.
We found a video, but NBC keeps taking all, because it was an NBC show, takes it all down. So we found one that's like a fan video, but you get to see the stuff we're talking about.
Oh, good. Hey, the box is fun.
Oh, he does say. Oh, I'm not going to put my lips on a black one.
Look, it's already gone bad.
All right.
Oh,
I'm going to go in a 69 position. You know what that is?
Oh, no. Yeah, you can't even get caught in new refrigerators.
No, they can.
Like, I don't know what that was all about. It was a real latch kind of a thing, and you couldn't get out. Now it's just that dumb magnetic strip.
Yeah, it's like the ice box, but now you can push yourself out.
I don't know. Why freezer, when you shut them, can't open them up again for a couple of seconds? very tight seal.
I take this boy and turn it into drum. Skin for drum to antagonize other white boy.
Ah, young buffalo girl. Young Tatanka girl stuck in refrigerator.
How does this one get burnt in fridge?
all right, is there any more of that?
No. Yeah, as Urock said, it's an NBC thing, so all the episodes are taken.
Fuck it, really? They're fucking with Punky Brewster clips?
I don't know.
Jesus.
Is it just because of the context of the show that it's so weird now?
I think they're just copyright people like Opie. They're trying to fucking...
Yeah.
Here's something I just couldn't imagine is happening. Actually, I could. Punky Brewster.
Oh.
All ready for a reboot.
Oh, Punky.
Oh, how are we going to reboot Punky?
Oh, boy. Bring over your big giant tits, Punky.
She did get those big giant tits.
She had huge tits.
You got to get them cut down.
Yeah, she had some tits removed.
You got to have them pruned.
I want to keep the parts that were taken from you, Punky. Punky.
So little Punky, I guess they're doing a reboot. She's going to be in it, I guess, as the mom?
Celeste Moonfry?
Is that it? Works?
We got a trailer.
Boy, do I love a trailer.
Good to see you, Punky Brewster.
Mom, you put on two different shoes.
Haven't done that in a while. Still works.
Raising three kids alone isn't easy.
All right.
I had to grow up.
Pause.
So she turned into a whore?
What the fuck is this? She got a black kid? She got a black kid.
So she has three out of wedlock children?
What is this?
She's like, I was out there.
Oh, no.
Punky brought home one of them, and I no longer let her into the house. I returned Punky.
The show's called Punky Coalburner. So now Punky's got... How does this work? Are they adopted? I don't know.
Isn't easy. I had to grow up. Ish.
Love TV icon.
It's how we rediscovered my Punky power.
Wait, go back. I saw something.
Was it her spitting into a cup and giving it to her kid?
Okay. Oh, wait.
It's how we rediscovered.
What's that? What is he?
Is that just a box of tissues on the table to clean up all his cum?
Was Punky an orphan?
I thought Punky was an orphan, and then the guy. The police academy.
Oh, I'm Ben Punky.
Yes, Punky.
Oh, Punky.
Oh, I'll take that one with the pigtails.
I have to climb out of the prison, Punky.
I've buttered your roller skates so you can't get away, Punky.
Now, while they haven't made her black, they have made it a very diverse cast. So, and I like the Golden Retriever.
My Punky power.
Of course. Punky power. The peacock!
I gave her the peacock.
So,
take my peacock.
Punky, take my peacock.
Use different shades of lipstick on it to make it colorful. Punky.
So is the peacock thing like NBC's version of CBS All Access? How much money do these people expect people to pay to see a reboot of Punky fucking Brewster?
Of all the things you can just put on your programming.
Yeah.
For free.
Yeah.
That's the fucking free one you're gonna wanna
now
do.
You gotta subscribe to it. Look. I know people are strapped these days and stuff, but we are absolutely giving you quality entertainment.
We are.
On a daily basis. You will not get this anywhere else, I assure you. But to have all these CBS All Access and Peacock, all these other networks, and everything's got a plus now, Discovery Plus,
They got Nat Geo Plus. So these are all pay
LGBTQ Plus.
Yes, the plus is the trans, I think.
Oh.
I'm not sure what the plus is.
Well, I don't see a plus there.
But they give you, they're just bilking people. And I love it. It's like, I cut the cord. I don't have cable anymore. And then you pay for all these fucking services. And it ends up being more than fucking cable.
It's
so.
Way more than cable.
Yeah.
And I still have fucking cable.
And I still have cable. You're right. I still have cable.
I do too.
And all these. And then you'll sign up for one thing. And then you'll just let it ride.
I'll forget about it until I'll look at like a credit card statement. And I'm like, oh yeah, I should do something about that.
Yeah,
and then I
what
don't.
The hell is that? Like CBS Plus, I get that now just for The Stand. I saw The Stand. I'm like, I got to watch it. I like the book. I want to be able to talk about it on the show.
Right.
So I could, you know, write it off on my taxes.
Exactly.
And yeah. But it's like, I'll probably forget.
Mm-hmm.
And then what am I going to watch on CBS? Fucking reboot of All in the Family?
Well, that's why I got Showtime. It was like 99 cents for a couple months. So I'm like, yeah, I'll get that. But I'm sure one day it'll be jacked up to $45. And
oh, yeah, and you'd be like, but it was 99 cents. 99 cents. What is this, 18.50?
That's why.
Nothing's 99.
Well, it's why they tricked me into it. I was like, oh, I'll fucking take that and watch Your Honor.